divide the reading. It's a lengthy reading. So we're going to read part of it before the prayer and then part of it after. So if you'll turn to Deuteronomy chapter 2, we're going to read verse 24 to chapter 3, verse 11. Just to remind you, the opening chapters of Deuteronomy are recounting the history of God's people, and particularly that second generation after the Exodus. So we see an entire generation of men who were of age to fight in battle were wiped out during the 40 years of wandering in the wilderness because of their unfaithfulness to obey the Lord's commands. And now there is this second generation that he is preparing to now go in to the promised land and to conquer the Canaanites and the other tribes and nations in the land of Canaan. Deuteronomy chapter 2, beginning in verse 24, we have a commandment to this second generation to begin to engage in warfare. Verse 24, rise up, set out on your journey and go over the valley of the Arnon. Behold, I have given into your hand Sihon the Amorite, king of Heshbon, and his land. Begin to take possession and contend with him in battle. This day I will begin to put the dread and fear of you on the peoples who are under the whole heaven, who shall hear the report of you and shall tremble and be in anguish because of you. So I sent messengers from the wilderness of Kedemoth to Sihon, the king of Heshbon, with words of peace, saying, let me pass through your land. I will go only by the road. I will turn aside neither to the right nor to the left. You shall sell me food for money that I may eat and give me water for money that I may drink. Only let me pass through on foot, as the sons of Esau who live in Seir and the Moabites who live in Ar did for me, until I go over the Jordan into the land that the Lord our God is giving to us. But Sihon, the king of Heshbon, would not let us pass by him. For the Lord your God hardened his spirit and made his heart obstinate, that he might give him into your hand, as he is this day. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have begun to give Sihon and his land over to you. Begin to take possession that you may occupy his land. Then Sihon came out against us, he and all his people, to battle at Jahaz. And the Lord our God gave him over to us, and we defeated him and his sons and all his people. And we captured all his cities at that time and devoted to destruction every city, men, women, and children. We left no survivors. Only the livestock we took as spoil for ourselves, with the plunder of the cities that we captured. From Aror, which is on the edge of the valley of the Arnon, and from the city that is in the valley, as far as Gilead, there was not a city too high for us. The Lord our God gave all into our hands. Only to the land of the sons of Ammon you did not draw near, that is, to the banks of the river Jabbok, and the cities of the hill country, whatever the Lord our God forbidden us. Then we turned and went up the way to Bashan, and Og, king of Bashan, came out against us, he and all his people, to battle at Edrei. But the Lord said to me, do not fear him, for I have given him and all his people and his land into your hand. And you shall do to him as you did to Sihon, the king of the Amorites, who lived in Heshbon. So the Lord our God gave into our hand Og also, the king of Bashan, and also his people, and we struck him down until he had no survivors left. And we took all his cities at that time. There was not a city that we did not take from them. 60 cities, the whole region of Argob, the kingdom of Og in Bashan. All these were cities fortified with high walls, gates, and bars, besides very many unwalled villages. And we devoted them to destruction, as we did to Sihon, the king of Heshbon, devoting to destruction every city, men, women, and children. But all the livestock and the spoil of the cities we took as our plunder. So we took the land at that time out of the hand of the two kings of the Amorites, who were beyond the Jordan, from the valley of the Arnon to Mount Hermon. The Sidonians call Hermon Sirion, while the Amorites call it Senir. All the cities of the tableland, and all Gilead, and all Bashan, as far as Salcah and Edrei, cities of the kingdom of Og in Bashan. For only Og, the king of Bashan, was left of the remnant of the Rephaim. Behold, his bed was a bed of iron. It is not in Rabbah of the Ammonites. 9 cubits was its length, and 4 cubits its breadth, according to the common cubit. So we'll come back to the remainder of our reading after our prayer. We're going to continue our reading. We'll pick up in chapter 3, verse 12, and we'll read down to verse 22. Deuteronomy 3:12, we read this. When we took possession of this land at that time, I gave to the Reubenites and the Gadites the territory beginning at Aroer, which is on the edge of the valley of Arnon, and half the hill country of Gilead with its cities. The rest of Gilead and all Bashan, the king of Og, that is, all the region of Argob, I gave to the half-tribe of Manasseh. All that portion of Bashan is called the land of Rephaim. Jair, the Manassite, took all the region of Argob, that is, Bashan, as far as the border of the Geshurites and the Maacathites, and called the villages after his own name, Havoth Jair, as it is to this day. To Machir, I gave Gilead, and to the Reubenites and the Gadites, I gave the territory from Gilead as far as the valley of the Arnon, with the middle of the valley as a border, as far over as the river Jabbok, the border of the Ammonites. The Arabah also, with the Jordan as the border from Chinnereth, as far as the Sea of the Arabah, the Salt Sea, under the slopes of Pisgah on the east. And I commanded you at that time, saying, the Lord your God has given you this land to possess. All your men of valor shall cross over armed before your brothers, the people of Israel. Only your wives, your little ones, and your livestock, I know that you have much livestock, shall remain in the cities that I have given you, until the Lord gives rest to your brothers as to you, and they also occupy the land that the Lord your God gives them beyond the Jordan. Then each of you may return to his possession, which I have given you. And I commanded Joshua at that time, your eyes have seen all that the Lord your God has done to these two kings. So will the Lord do to all the kingdoms into which you are crossing. You shall not fear them, for it is the Lord your God who fights for you. This is the word of the Lord. What we see in chapters 2 and 3 of Deuteronomy is the Lord strengthening the faith and the confidence of his people in his abiding presence and in his protection of them. This is really the main thrust of what God is doing in Deuteronomy 2 and 3. It's as if the nation of Israel, the second generation, is attending his school of faith. You remember the problem with the first generation, their forefathers. What prevented them from entering into the promised land? Unbelief. They lacked faith. Here they were faced with this, what to them was an insurmountable challenge. We have to go up and fight these heavily fortified cities and these well-trained warriors. How can we do that? They viewed it from a purely earthly perspective, as if God was not their God and they were not his people. So the Lord prepares this second generation to engage in battle. And we see he does that in two ways. He's disciplined the nation of Israel. So all of the men who are of age to fight in the military perished in the wilderness during a 40-year period of time. That would have been the fathers of many of the children in this second generation. They would have felt very keenly the emotional effects of the Lord's discipline. You can imagine. They knew why their fathers had perished, but that's still a painful experience, and no doubt one, a form of discipline that is highly effective. But the Lord also instructs them through experience. And that's really a lot of what we're going to see here. But I want us to look at the fruit of his discipline in the section that we've read. And then the second point we're going to look at is the education they receive through experience. There's a lot of text, and it's probably hard, you know, to see how all of this stuff ties together and what we can take from it. But I hope you benefit from it to some extent tonight. So the first thing, the fruit of the discipline that the Lord had enacted on his people during the wilderness wandering. I want to remind you of Israel's purpose, and we talked about this 2 weeks ago, last time I preached in the evening. This nation was to prefigure the work of Christ. They were to paint a picture in the outworking of their own history of the work that Christ would bring at a future time. So if you turn with me to the prophet Hosea. That's the first prophet after the book of Daniel. I think this verse in Hosea 11:1 really encapsulates this teaching. And if you tie it with Matthew 2, verse 15, in the birth narrative of Christ, you see a bridge, a link between Israel at this point in their history and the coming of Christ. In Hosea 11:1, Hosea writes these words, "When Israel was a child." Now, I've used that theme to describe this early history of Israel. They're like a child growing into maturity. "When Israel was a child, I loved him. Out of Egypt, I called my son." Now, that ultimately is foreshadowing the birth narrative of Christ. Christ is under hostility with Herod. He flees to where? Egypt. And then in Matthew 2:15, this statement is used when Christ returns back into the land of the Jews. "Out of Egypt I called my son." Now, they were to foreshadow, to picture, to typify the work of Christ. And the Exodus, the story of the Exodus from Egypt, is the central picture of redemption in the Old Testament. It's a picture of the saving work of Christ outworked in the history of the Old Testament people. The failure of the first generation didn't paint the picture that God wanted to paint through the existence and the outworking of the history of the people of Israel. You think of an architect, and he's preparing a magnificent structure, a beautiful building. What does he do to prefigure the final work? Sometimes we see, you know, these magnificent structures, and there's some type of a scale model that kind of prepares everyone for what it's going to look like. That's a good way of thinking of Israel in the Old Testament, or the blueprints to show us what things are going to look like when Christ comes. Well, if the model doesn't reflect the ideal or the end product, what's the architect going to do? He's going to have the person who draws the blueprints or the person who creates the scale model to adjust it and to fix it so that it accurately reflects his plan and intention. And that's what the Lord does through his discipline. He cannot have these people acting in unbelief. He must have them trusting in him to be a true reflection of the obedient sonship of Jesus Christ. God exercises discipline to train Israel to carefully obey his commands. And if you know anything, and I know most of you do, it is powerfully effective. It is a night and day difference between the first generation of Israelites compared to the second generation up to and through the leadership of Joshua. It's after Joshua that the wheels start to fall off a little bit. And the Lord has to bring them through the process of the judges, that time period in the Bible, where he's again disciplining them and training them until he gets to David and Solomon. And it's in the histories of David and Solomon that Israel reaches its pinnacle, its golden age, where they really reflect the glory of the coming Christ. And then after Solomon, it's a mess until Christ returns. So that's a little overview of some of the history of the nation. Now, there is a repeat of the Exodus that's described in the reading that we've just done. And you may not have really picked up on it. What was the point of the Exodus? Why did God demonstrate his power and glory through those 10 plagues? What was he doing to that generation of people? Building faith. Building faith. If God can redeem you from the hand of Pharaoh, then what should make you think that he cannot give you victory over these mighty nations in the land of Canaan? If you turn back to chapter 1 of Deuteronomy, we see the crisis in Israel as they send the spies out and they're terrified by these people. And then in verse 29, Moses says this interesting statement. Then I said to you, do not be in dread or afraid of them. The Lord your God who goes before you will himself fight for you, just as he did for you in Egypt before your eyes. Look, guys, don't you remember how strange is it? I mean, what if you lived in this time period and you witnessed the 10 plagues in Egypt and you saw God's mighty power and you saw the Red Sea divide and open up and you go through and then the Egyptian army comes behind you and it's swallowed up in the ocean, in the waters. Man, wouldn't you be confident in God? You would think. How hard must the human heart be? You know, we think, well, if we could only witness some of the miracles that Christ performed, our faith would be so much stronger. That's not necessarily true. There were people who walked next to Christ who witnessed all of these things and still rejected him. It's not those outward expressions that we need. It's an inward work of the Holy Spirit that enables us to believe these things. So the Exodus was there to prepare that first generation, to strengthen them for the work that they were going to do as they went into the land of Canaan and started to conquer many of the tribes and nations there. God demonstrated his power in Egypt to encourage their faith. So what's he doing? They're not entering into the promised land yet. And they're going to engage with these two kings, Og and Sihon. Why? That's what I want you to think about tonight. What is God doing? Here's a generation, a second generation, who didn't know what happened in Egypt, not by experience. They would have heard the stories, no doubt, from their family members and fellow Israelites, but they didn't witness them firsthand. There's a couple of things going on with the conquest of Sihon and Og. First of all, God is reminding the nations of Canaan that his 40 years of wilderness wandering, that time of peace and quiet, doesn't mean that he's abandoned his people. Look at chapter 2, verse 25. This day I will begin to put the dread and fear of you on the peoples who are under the whole heaven, who shall hear the report of you and shall tremble and be in anguish because of you. And then look at chapter 2, verse 30. And tell me if you see a striking resemblance between one of these kings and Pharaoh in Egypt. In chapter 2, verse 30, we read this about Sihon. But Sihon, the king of Heshbon, would not let us pass by him. For the Lord your God hardened his spirit and made his heart obstinate, that he might give him into your hands as he is this day. Anybody else not want to let God's people go? Guy named Pharaoh. Anybody else, are we told that God hardened his heart, made him obstinate? Pharaoh in Egypt, so that God could demonstrate to his people. It's really a very sweet and a precious way in which God deals with us. He doesn't just say to them, go do it. He begins to demonstrate to them his power, so that they can experience it to some degree before they have to go to battle against some of the mighty people in the land of Canaan. So we learn that God is very gracious in his dealings with his people. He's very patient in molding them into a godly nation. We also learn that his discipline is always for the good of his people. It promotes holiness, it stimulates greater faith and obedience. So we see some of the work of his discipline, but now I want to turn to the education he provides them through experience. We've already, there's a little overlap here, we've touched on it a little bit. There are some barriers to faith that we see in this story and that we experience ourselves. And one of the greatest barriers to faith, really is the grounds and the basis for why faith is necessary, is this. What we perceive seems to be inconsistent with the promises of God. God promises Israel the land of Canaan. And maybe they're thinking, hey, we're just going to cross the border and it's ours. It doesn't work that way. He says, you got to fight for it. You've got to engage in battle. And maybe that resonates with some of you today and with me as well. God says, I've given you a new heart. I've taken out the stony heart. I've given you a heart of flesh. I will cause you to obey my commandments. And maybe we think when we read passages like that, man, that's going to be easy. But then we find out that we actually have to fight with sin. That God has given us the capacity, but then he expects us to act upon it in faith. So the number one barrier to faith is that what we perceive seems inconsistent with the promises. The Israelites were not warriors, but slaves. They had no training. They weren't battle-tested guys. Could you imagine the hopelessness of this second generation? They see their fathers die in the wilderness, and they've got to take up the task of entering Canaan and conquering it. That's got to be terrifying. And not only are they not trained in warfare, the people of Canaan are. They're mighty. Their cities seem impenetrable, as we read about in chapter 1, verse 28. There's two means by which God deals with these barriers. One is what we read about last time, where he takes them through this very odd journey through Seir and Moab. They're in the wilderness. They start going back towards the Red Sea. It seems like just an odd thing. And God says, we're going to walk you through the nations of Seir and Moab. You're not allowed to engage in warfare. I want you to just see what I've done for them. I've made promises to them, just like I've made to you. And they had to overcome people with mighty fortified cities, and I fulfilled those promises. I allowed and enabled them to gain victory. So they got to see it, but he takes them one step further in developing their faith. Here he allows them to experience some of his power and his trustworthiness in fulfilling his promises. He allows Israel to taste and see that the Lord is indeed good. Sihon and Og are almost like a test run for them. They are like the people of Canaan. Turn to chapter 2, verse 36. That was part of our reading tonight. And we read these words. From Aroer, which is on the edge of the valley of the Arnon, and from the city that is in the valley as far as Gilead, there was not a city too high for us. The Lord our God gave all into our hand. So the cities of Sihon were these fortified cities like they were going to face in the land of Canaan. And then in chapter 3, verse 5, we hear of Og and his territories. Verse 5 says, all these were cities fortified with high walls, gates, and bars, besides very many unwalled villages. And we devoted them to destruction. It's a beautiful picture of God's dealings with his children. He doesn't just cast them to the wolves, so to speak. Do you see what's been going on from chapter 2 into chapter 3? It's tender in how he deals with them. He's not rough. He's very patient and cautious in developing them and preparing them for this great work that they are about to perform. That's how he is with our faith. You got the picture of Thomas after Christ's resurrection. Jesus doesn't just say, hey, Thomas, get over it, man, believe. Now, come here. Put your fingers in the holes where they hammered those nails through my hands and feel the side where they poked it. That's how God is with us in developing and strengthening our faith. Now, there is an advantage we have over these people, and that's the measure in which we have the Holy Spirit, which enables us to grasp and to believe things sometimes without a lot of the experience that God allows his people to witness. Gideon, he had to go and conquer some people in the time period of the Judges. What does God say to him? Just do it? Just believe I'm going to be there? No, Gideon asks for God to do some things, to perform some miracles to strengthen his faith, and God obliges him. So they had these fortified cities. They had mighty warriors. We read in chapter 3, verse 11, of a bed that they found. For only Og, the king of Bashan, was left of the remnant of the Rephaim. Behold, his bed was a bed of iron. It is not in, or is it not in Rabbah of the Ammonites? 9 cubits was its length, 4 cubits its breadth, according to the common cubit. Now, we all know what the common cubit is. So you have no doubt in your mind about what this bed was like. Well, for those of you who may have forgotten the common cubit, it was a bed about 13 feet long by 6 feet wide. That was a big man. And you can understand the fear of the Israelites. They went in, the second generation, and they defeated these two great mighty kings. And it prepares them for their future. I was going to talk a little bit about understanding this total destruction, total annihilation, but I'm not going to do that tonight. I'm going to hold off on that. I just want to close by looking at chapter 3, verse 21. I think this ties everything together in terms of what the Lord is doing here. This school of faith that he's been leading them on culminates in the statement in chapter 3, verse 21. Moses writes, "And I commanded Joshua at that time, 'Your eyes have seen all that the Lord your God has done to these two kings. So will the Lord do to all the kingdoms in which you are crossing. You shall not fear them, for it is the Lord your God who fights for you.'" That's the purpose of all of this wandering around in the wilderness and then the encounters and engagement with Sihon and Og, to give Israel confidence, to build and strengthen their faith, for them to understand that just as God delivered Sihon and Og, so too will he deliver to them all of the lands of Canaan. I just want you to reflect upon that. I want you to think, surely our God deals with us in a similar way. He doesn't just cast us off and say, "This is my promise, just deal with it." Oftentimes, he gives us little hints and little glimpses of his faithfulness along the way. You've probably experienced that to some degree. Some of you may feel, "I should ask God for this because I feel as if I don't know what he's doing in my life." But this is how he is. This is a reflection of our gracious God. Let me pray. Father, we come to you tonight and we confess that oftentimes we really don't understand you. In the midst of what appears to be harshness on your part in destroying a whole generation of fighting men, we see beautiful pictures in the midst of that story, beautiful pictures of your tender and loving care for your people. And Father, we pray that that would enlighten us and help us to understand more of how you work with your people. We pray, O Lord, that you would strengthen our faith, for we feel at times as if it is almost non-existent. Lord, we have faith, but strengthen our faith as we heard a man pray in the Gospels. Lord, we ask all of these things humbly in the name of Christ. Amen.